I'm intrigued by a statement that you made earlier, Chris.
That would be
back to normal. Do any of us dare to define what normal is anymore? Because about every week we go through some process and we say, well, wow, this must be the new normal. And but hey, here we are. And there's some certain normal stuff about today, and that is the fact that you're here, and I'm glad you're here, and I'm really glad I get to be here, only because the options for me of not being here would be tough. I want to start in a series of teachings about our faith and about the Christian community. And there are certain qualities about my Bible that I really appreciate the fact, and that is that that part of it is printed in red. And you understand that if your Bible has red printing in it, the red is the words that Jesus spoke himself. And those are the words we really need to get a hold of. We do a lot of teaching on we believe this and we believe this and we think this is going to happen and we believe this and suddenly, and then Jesus comes along and says, yes, but let me tell you something the way it really is, and you can always count on that. And there's some reading I want to give you right now that kind of identifies that. And if you have your Bible, I'd like you to join with me in the 6th chapter of Matthew. And I want to just do some work with you this morning on comparing God's righteousness with our tendency toward self-righteousness. I'm sure you are aware by now that I'd really work hard at not being a self-righteous person, and that if it wasn't for something that he gave me into my life, considerably different than what I was before, I don't know what mafia gang I would be in today. But the Lord's grace says, no, I don't want you to do that. I want you to be over here. And so he does something in us, something wonderfully mysterious almost, and that is that he makes us after his own image, teaches us his own teachings, gives us a righteousness that we learn the rest of our lives how to understand and live out. And so Matthew chapter 6 reads like this, and I'm reading out of the NIV version this morning. Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with the trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be honored by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be done in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen of men. I tell you the truth, they receive their reward in full. When you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what you've done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive them when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. If you do not forgive men their sins, your Father in heaven will not forgive you yours. And when you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show men that they are fasting. I tell you the truth, they've received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your face and wash your face so that it will not be observed to men that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you openly. I have been just pondering this statement, just this phrase, your acts of righteousness. The word is, be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men to be seen of them. The implication is, though, to do them. And he identifies three areas that we need to be doing. One is giving to the needy. One is praying. One is fasting. And there's a lot of other areas of acts of righteousness. And it was Jesus who said to us, to his disciples, and he was comparing what he was teaching them to what they had been taught in the synagogue in a traditional religious system of the old Jewish culture. And he said to them, listen, you've got to find a way to make sure that your righteousness is more honest and more real than the righteousness displayed by those in the synagogue, because they are filled with self-righteousness. They promote themselves to be seen and build a reputation of somehow being spiritual because of either how they give or how they pray or how they look when they fast. So Jesus comes along and says, wait a minute, we need to redefine this thing of righteousness. And right, isn't righteous a interesting word? Righteous. Matter of fact, I remember the Righteous Brothers. You remember them? They were good. I don't know if they were righteous. but I thought, maybe that was their last name. Maybe they were the Righteous Brothers. I don't know. I know this, that the word righteous in my mind is an interesting word. But in the biblical sense, do you know what righteousness means and righteous means? It merely means finding a proper right relationship to God. A right relationship to God. Now, do you have a right relationship to God? And how do any of us define that? I can kind of define that for me, based on my understanding, based on my upbringing, based on my teaching, based on my understanding of the word, I can define that for me. But you know what? I can't define or describe your right relationship to God. You know why? Because it's yours. I don't know the relationship you have with the person sitting next to you, let alone the right relationship with God. But here he defines in this text acts of righteousness, meaning behavior on our part that is motivated by our right relationship to God. Now, what is that? Well, James suggests that, and quoting out of the King James, pure religion and undefiled before God is this. to visit the fatherless and the widows in their afflictions, and to keep yourself free from the patterns of this world. Pure religion and undefiled, James calls it. I think the NIV calls it something like a religious experience acceptable to God. And then he describes it as acts of kindness toward the widow and the orphan and the needy, and to make sure that in all of this outgoing of care for other people in need, we don't forget that there's an inward motivation that's always got to be pure and purified and worked through in the whole thing in the world. Paul goes into that teaching in Romans 12 that we commit our lives a living sacrifice to God, and to not be conformed to this, to the pattern of the world, but be transformed by the continual renewing of our mind, so that our mind is that part of us that touches into God himself in a relational issue. And so he talks about being careful to avoid falling into a pattern dictated to us by our culture. I'm not sure that I'm excited about being counterculture, except you are really counterculture, okay? Which means that you have a pattern of lifestyle and living requirements that is not dictated to you by your culture, but is dictated to you by a much bigger, broader sense. And so in this process, he says, now listen, he says, there are three things I want you to be sensitive to. I want you to be sensitive to your attitude toward giving, toward praying, and toward fasting. And I want to concentrate for a moment on this whole thing about attitude. Why we do what we do. The implication is that if we're not careful, we do our righteousness, we do our good deeds, we do our kind acts to somehow draw attention to ourselves rather than to the reason, the real reason that we're doing anything, and that is somebody else has a need or somebody else has in these three cases, somebody is referred to as the needy that we're called to help. But to make sure that we don't do it like the hypocrites do. That's an interesting word in itself. The hypocrites. Now, his Jesus reference was apparently to the Pharisees. And in the temple synagogue worship in that day, there were three groups of spiritual leaders. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the Essenes. And they were all significant in their theologies of their relationship to God. But the Pharisees particularly kind of drifted into this whole issue of hypocrisy in terms of saying they cared for the people, but then when they cared for the people, they did it in such a way that it drew more attention to themselves and what they were doing. Now, I don't know if you've ever fallen into this trap or not. I can confess to you I've fallen into this trap. And that is that God really calls us to really examine our hearts toward giving. Giving to the needy. Giving to the poor. Giving to, it's not just money, but it's time, it's energy, it's encouragement, it's instruction. It's helping somebody like today. I have an idea today you're going to have an opportunity to help somebody because we're in a major storm issue right now. What will you do if your neighbor's fence falls over this afternoon? Are you willing to get out there with him and pick it up? Or if an intersection floods over, are you willing to get out with a hoe and clean out the gutter level there so it'll drain the water? Just acts. Those are kind acts. And those are right things to do. But I can remember times when I've been sitting over here or here somewhere, and we take the offering, and I feel particularly generous. And so I look at my wallet, and I pull out a $100 bill. There's a little tendency in us to fold it in such a way that the person next to us especially can see what we're giving. So they'll think we're generous. And, oh, wow, he sacrifices for the needs of other people. And then you are caught in your spirit. You're caught. You're thinking, you phony guy. You hypocrite. You hypocrite. Why are you giving it all? Put it away. Remember this, God doesn't need your money ever. He's got enough. It is not as if we are building him a bankroll. Okay? It's not it. He's got enough. The scripture says he owns the cattle on the 1,000 hills. And if he needs a little bit more, he can just sell a cow. No problem with that idea. You see, but we come right back to attitude of why we do what we do. We all like to help other people. We all like to bless somebody else. We all like to lift somebody's burden that's heavy, heavy laden with cares. We like to doing that. But we also like to be noticed for what it is we're doing. Now, it does not say that you will not be noticed. It does not say that you should not be noticed necessarily. It says not to do it to be noticed. And if you give a good, kind deed, somebody will observe it. But that's not why you did it. I hope. You do it because you're complying with the issue of being free. Now, Jesus identifies these three areas that he apparently wants us to be particularly aware of. One is giving, one is praying, one is fasting. And he's referring to them as acts of kindness. He says, make sure that you don't do your acts of kindness to be seen of men, because as soon as you do it to be seen, you have your reward. Now, thank you. I want more than that in return. I only use the term pulling out a $100 bill out of your wallet because you don't know if I ever do that or not. Okay, you don't know that, do you? And I'm not telling you I'm doing that. I'm just saying that I can give with the wrong attitude. Matter of fact, much of our whole giving process has got to be re-examined periodically from our own heart level. For instance, why do we give to the Lord? Do you realize how difficult it is to comply with the Lord's challenge to bring a tithe of the first fruits to the Lord? Do you realize what that means? A tithe? That means a tenth. There are many people in this congregation who faithfully give a tenth of their income to the Lord. And you don't have to ever wonder why they are absolutely blessed of the Lord in their own personal lives because of it, because you can watch it happen. But I say to you who attempt to do that and really want to do that and sometimes don't feel like you can, I want you to know that giving is one of the most difficult things you're ever asked to do. Giving money, that's hard. And that's one of the reasons why Dennis is always lifting your burden off of that and saying, look, if you're struggling with it, don't do it. I'm okay with that most of the time until the budget really gets tight. I'm thinking, Dennis, hearten that up a little bit. Come on. But it's only because you forget for a moment that all of this, listen, all of this is God's. None of this belongs to any of us. We are caretakers and stewards of his stuff. And he says, I will provide for you everything you need. And he does that through other means and other people who he speaks to about giving, and that's what's okay. The important thing that I want to always admonish you to do is to make sure, first of all, that you recognize something. And I use tithing as a very difficult thing, but I want to also challenge you this, because there's a lot of people who, when they write their tithe check and they put it in the envelope, most of you do it before you ever come to church. You can make a mistake of thinking then your giving is complete. I paid my tithe. Yeah, but your tithe doesn't go to the needy. Your tithe goes to the work of the Lord. And then he refers to another act called giving of alms. Alms for the poor. And it is our Colonel Sanders bucket. You will not find one church in 1,000 who every service passes an alms bucket. But you do. And you do because you care for the needy. And we give thousands of dollars every year to the needy. You don't hear a lot about that. You know why? Because we want God's blessings on that giving, not just to be, we don't do it to be seen, we don't do it to obligate anybody, we don't do it to buy anybody's favor. We do it because we determine somebody has a need and we are able to meet that need and make their life a little bit better because somebody else gave and gave willfully. And so the Lord comes to us and says, okay, you need to learn how to give. You need to learn how to tithe. You need to learn how to give above the tithe. And a tithing is 10%. And so how about making a goal for your own finances of 20%? Well, I'm not putting that on you. I'm always saying, you know, the needy would love it. The needy would love it. And we would give it. Okay? I don't know if you're aware of the fact that there have been times, listen, you as a congregation, do you know that you have paid for funerals for people in our community whose names and families we do not even know? We've come to the distress of families regularly who are in trouble financially for utility bills. That's almost routine with us. But there are times that, and I had this wonderful conversation, almost a person, a wonderful believer who didn't believe we would even do something like that, paying a funeral cost for somebody whose name we don't know, paying for a cremation of somebody whose loved one died and they had no ability to do anything beyond that. We didn't do it to be seen. We didn't do it even to be thanked by the family. We did it because we had a motivation somewhere to do it. And so the Lord says, remember this. Remember that your acts of kindness, which involves your giving, make sure it's done with a right heart. And then he says, you who do it with a right heart will be rewarded by God. And in one of the versions of the scripture, it talks about, here it just says that the Father will reward you. And one of the versions says that he'll reward you openly. Okay? He sees in secret, he rewards you openly. And then he says, and here's where I'm going to spend a lot of time for the next month, and that is the next area of act of kindness, and that is this. We all know we need to pray more. Praying. And listen, it doesn't matter where you are, what your relationship to God is even at this point. You know, there's an old saying that came out of, I think it came out of World War II or something like that, that there are no atheists in the foxholes. In a foxhole or in a trench, in a warfare, they're all praying. Oh God, help me not to die today. or something of that nature. Or we've been in a crisis moment in time and we said, oh God, help me now. Oh God, just save me right now. And then at that point, we make all kind of deals. You know, God, if you save me this one more time, I'll go to Africa as a missionary if you say so. But we all know we need to pray more. Here's the dilemma with that. And I know this by personal distress. The more you pray, the more you know you need to pray. And there's no end to that cycle. And so you have to change the ways that you pray so that you can spend more time in some kind of communion with God that takes you off of your knees or off of your chair or off of your table you're praying at and takes you in a place where it's kind of like, okay, God, we've got a lot of things to do today. We've spent some time in prayer. Now let's go. And we're talking about our day all day long. This is my understanding, and I remember a good evangelist friend of mine, a great guy from Wales, great preacher, but he was, yeah, a Welshman. He was talking about, he said, Rhodes, learn to practice the presence of God all day long. I've really tried that with my lifetime. And you might come in contact with me at some time in some place, and I don't look like I'm in prayer. Because the scripture says, don't go around looking like you're in prayer. Just be in prayer. Just be in fellowship with God. And so he says, remember this when you pray. And then he goes into this whole thing, and this is how we're going to break this down for probably the next month. He says, this is how you should pray. And then he talks about our Father who art in heaven. Father, help me in my relationship to you. Anybody here knows God enough? No. We're all in process. We're all in process. I can tell you this. I know God a whole lot better than I used to. And I don't know God near enough as I'm going to. And wherever I am now, I'm passing through this to something else. And experiences teaches us to ask God for help in the middle of it. And believe me, there's things in my own family that I'm thinking, oh God, help us all. We need your guidance. We need your help. We need just a confirming sense of direction for what we need to be doing next. And I'm praying that all day long. But the principle is this: how do you pray? We have people who. Dennis comes up every service after singing and says a prayer. I appreciate his prayers. The fact that he doesn't get lengthy or extremely articulate in vocabulary. But I've heard other people pray who are still praying in some kind of a King James view of thous and these and thuses, and I have no problem with them doing it. I can't do that. I never learned how to pray that way. And then I also find myself, I find myself doing this, and I don't want to do this, but I find myself doing this. You come up here after the service and you say, I need you to pray for me. I have a terrible backache. Please pray for the Lord to touch my back. So I say, okay. So I pray. Now listen, I could pray that in one sentence. Oh God, here's my brother Roy. He has a backache. Heal him. End of prayer. But you see, in our culture, it doesn't sound like a prayer because it's too short. Huh? And so what do I do? Well, I better lengthen this out because I know God heard me, but I'm not sure that Roy heard me. So I pray a second time, oh God, help Roy's back. And it's simple enough, it's real enough. But somehow, I go through the process about five different times. Approaching the subject five different ways, as if God doesn't know what his back's about. Okay, now listen, God doesn't need me to tell him what his back's about. God needs somebody to exercise some faith for his need. It can be as simple. Now, there are times when you need to spend time in prayer. That's a little different in praying for a situation like this. And so the scripture says, now listen, when you pray and you need to spend some time talking to the Lord about your life and your issue and your problems of life, but you need to talk it through. You need to learn to talk to God about all kinds of things in a very natural way. It says, go to your closet, close the door, be alone, and then talk to God. I say to people all the time, talk to God in a way that you talk to a friend here. Because God is not going to hear something from you that surprises him. Okay? God isn't going to hear something from you that he didn't already know. So talk to him about being real. The point that I want to share with you this morning, and I want to kind of wrap this up with this statement, and that is this, whether we're talking about giving or serving or helping or praying, just remember that we are all in this commonly together, helping each other find better ways to walk this faith out in a real way that doesn't make us sound self-aggrandizing. For instance, I know a lot of good preacher friends of mine that have no problem telling everybody that they're a preacher. I learned a long time ago not to do that. First time I was pulled over by a cop for speeding, and I want to talk my way out of it. Well, you know, I'm a pastor. I'm going to the hospital to help somebody. I'll tell you the truth. It doesn't work, so don't try it. But I learned a long time ago that it was a bad testimony to that cop. Here I was, a law-abiding believer breaking the law and then try to talk my way out of it. Now, I have talked my way out of a few, but my approach has changed totally. Mercy is good. Ignorance is not too workable, but you know, that's the way life is. Listen, are you along with me somewhere along this that says, you know, we just have to learn to be real? Just be real. If you're not feeling well, don't pretend to God that you're going to be okay. Sometimes you just got to say, God, I'm sick. I'm tired. I'm not well. Have you ever had an argument with God? Have you ever lost one? Have you ever won one? You got to learn to be real. We're going to continue this at another time. I need you to stand with me. And I took a little longer than I normally do this morning. I just want to set some groundwork for what I'm going to be sharing with you in the next several weeks, about doing our acts of kindness, doing our acts of righteousness. And you know what? This whole thing of Christianity, it's not about us. It's about our response to God. It's about the Lord. This is all his. We get to be a little bit arrogant that we kind of take ownership of it in a certain selfish way. I don't want people to tell other people that, oh yeah, I go to Rhodes Pringles Church. I'd love to be able to say that, but you can't touch that. I can't touch that because it's not mine. I want to be his, but I want to be it real in the best way I can. Let's pray together. Are we singing, Becky, or are we just turning him loose? Okay, I'll turn him loose. There's a good cup of coffee on your way out. You might need a good cup of coffee before you meet the weather outside. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, thank you for every person here this morning. Thank you for your word, because your word is life and instructive and encouraging. It gives us a sense of direction for our own behavior. And may we understand what being righteous is, and then how to act righteously as a point of maturity. Bless your people this morning, I pray. Thank you for the morning. Keep your hand of safety on every one of us, I pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for being here. Bless you as you go.